Yeah, good morning. We are happy to have you. Many of you, or at least some of you, have requested in the past, let's get back to having some prelude music. And thank you, team, for doing that. Yeah. Beautiful. This morning, I just got a couple of things I want to point out to you. Many of you, hopefully all of you, know that we have been working on a new board structure. Today is the first day that we are going to be officially accepting nominations for people willing to serve on that board. If you look at your bulletin, there is a timeline broken down of when we're going to accept, when they're going to be voted upon, and that type of process. So please, when you have a minute, take some time to review that information. Next, you will see out in the foyer on the little table, Easter devotions are available. Go ahead and take one if you'd like to participate in this. In addition, coming up here in March 7th actually, it's exciting, we'll be having yet another new small group opportunity. Hopefully you're aware that we have recently, first of the year, started a study on conquering your Goliath, which is held in here. Well, Diane will be starting on March 7th a small group study on the book of Ecclesiastes. If you are interested in joining her class, please sign up in the fellowship or the foyer, rather, so that we know how much material to order. That class is open to anybody who would just like to try something new, do the study with her. And then I would like to also point out, just because I know it's an issue, the offering trays are still available. They're usually sitting out front. We have moved them. If you look in the back of the sanctuary right now, they are right under the big circle window. So maybe on your way in, your way out, feel free to toss it in there. And there you go. The last thing I want to share with all of you is every Sunday we make this announcement, and I've moved it to this morning in the announcement portion to invite you or remind you, if you are interested in membership, belong to this church family as a member, or if you want more information on being baptized, that information is always available to you. You can see me after service. You can call our church office, and we will get with you and share that information so that it is available and so that you can continue in your relationship and growth. I want to take one quick second. I'll give you 2 seconds. If I look around, wave at each other, greet each other before we pray and get into service. Thank you all for braving the cold, by the way. It's chilly out there. Mm-hmm. All right, let's pray together. Almighty Father, we thank you for the blessing and opportunity you've given us to be present in your place this morning. We pray that you prepare our hearts to worship and receive what you have for us. We pray that you be with those who cannot join us physically in this place, that they may feel your presence just as they are sitting here with us. Hear our praise, Lord God, and fill us with your presence. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Just stand up and worship with us this morning. We're going to sing about the constant love of God this morning.
Out on me, your love satisfies my soul. And I never, ever have to be afraid. One thing remains. One thing remains.
Your love. Your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me.
Your love never fails. It never gives up. It never runs out on me.
God, we just come to you. We bow our hearts to you. We're just so thankful. We're thankful for the world's best Valentine's gift that we could ever ask for, that you gave your son because you love us. Because you set us free from sin, but we just thank you so much for your love, Father God. We focus on you. As you examine our hearts this morning, Father God, we come to you and we just lift our voice in worship because we love you and we love you for loving us. We thank you that you are the lover of our soul.
Jesus, lover of my soul. You go.
something from 1 Corinthians. I got a little excited and started praying. Would you pull us back to 1 Corinthians, Scott, for me at the beginning there? Such a good reminder. Love is patient. Love is kind. Does not envy. It does not boast. Will you read these words with me? It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. We just, what a great reminder for this morning. What a great reminder for believers. When you don't feel like God's with you, He is there and He loves you. We're going to sing so loud these words as a great reminder of that love.
Jesus, lover of my soul. Jesus, I will never let you go.
Cling to the cross.
You've taken me from the miry clay. You've set my feet upon the rock, and now I know. Until the
Would you be seated? Tom's going to come up and give us the word of the Lord.
Good morning again. Welcome. Thank you for joining us. We love to have you as we worship the Lord together. Before we get in the service at this time, I'd like to invite our children all the way through fifth grade if they'd like to go back to our FBC Kids Super Awesome Fun Kids Church. The volunteers are wearing the cool shirts standing in the back. Feel free to join them. If you're a visitor, you are also more than welcome to join them. Such a beautiful sight, seeing all those kids go back. Well, does anybody know what today is? Valentine's Day. I thought it was, but I didn't have any candies on my desk, so I wasn't sure. So it's Valentine's Day. Today is a day that we now celebrate love in various ways. We celebrate love for the people in our lives. Some people give their pets valentines, friends. It's just become a day of sharing love, which is great. However, you know, as I got to thinking about it, it's always fun just to do an encyclopedia search. Well, what's it say about Valentine's Day? Let me tell you what it says. Before it was the more commercial holiday that it is today with cards and gifts and things, it was a celebration that was named for a few Christian martyrs, one of which would supposedly marry couples, which was defying the Roman emperor's orders in order to protect them from having to go to war. So if you were married, you didn't have to go. So supposedly that's part of it. And because they were killed for disobeying the orders, they became martyrs, and therefore their names were attached to the day. But that's not where it first came from. Let's look back even further. Before it was named for the Christian martyrs, it was actually a celebration of a Roman festival that celebrated fertility. And women would be paired off with men by lottery. So they get together for a festival, celebrate fertility, and then by lottery, women would be assigned to men. Oh, how far we've come, huh? Now we give little heart candies to each other. I think it's more appropriate. Anyway, so this is a love month, right? I mean, I kind of joked about that with Valentine's Day, and we decided to look at stories of love from Scripture. Now, I was intentional in saying stories of love and not love stories just because the connotation changes. You hear love stories and automatically, at least in my mind, it goes romantic. Stories of love, that leaves a little more leeway, a little more lateral movement opportunity. So last week, we started off the month, and we looked at the divine friendship between David and Jonathan and how it demonstrated love. We looked at how it separated someone who's loving from something that they love. We saw how David was loved by Jonathan. If you paid attention last week, you kind of saw that more often. You'd hear, Jonathan loved David. Jonathan had David reaffirm his love for his family. Jonathan this, Jonathan that. We don't see a lot about David saying, I love Jonathan. Now we see the commitment and covenants made, which tells us that it was a mutual love. But that's important to realize when you looked at the context of the story. Because Jonathan loved David, he gave up everything to protect him and care for him. So that's like a brotherly love, friend closer than family, a divine love. And we also talked very briefly how that type of love mirrored or exemplified for us what it could mean, at least partially, to love your neighbor as yourself. That passage we studied last week said this several times. Jonathan loved David as himself. Their souls were knit together. He loved him as himself. So when we think about how we love each other as ourselves, as Jesus tells us, we can look to Jonathan and David for some examples. And now this morning, being Valentine's Day, and the fact that we're celebrating love, a romantic style mostly, we're looking at one expression of love, a romantic expression. A husband and wife type of love, which comes to us from Jacob and Rachel. Most of you probably know this story. If you do, you can shake your head, yeah. If not, you can still shake your head, yeah, and I won't know. But so we'll move into the story of Jacob and Rachel and see how their love can teach us. Before we get into the passage, I'll give a little backstory or a little back information, a little context to Jacob. When you hear Jacob, oftentimes, at least for me, you think of, oh, wonderful servant of the Lord. Well, when you look at Jacob's younger life and the stories that we have about him, he was kind of a hooligan. A whole bunch of shenanigans and trickery and deceit that was practiced in his life against his father to come out ahead. He deceived his own father to receive a blessing. Manipulated his brother to get his inheritance. There was no lack of shenanigans going on. And so Jacob lived in the home with his family, and he had no wife. Which is interesting because his mom, as we'll learn, his mother was the one who kickstarted the movement to get him a wife. She also kickstarted the movement to deceive, too, but we'll look at that later. So by the urging of his parents, they sent Jacob out. Hey, go get a wife. Go to the land of your mother's brother, which was Laban, okay? So they kicked him out and said, go find a wife. When Jacob arrived, he saw Rachel, which happened to be Laban's younger daughter. So it's his uncle, the younger daughter of his uncle. Get this, he just saw her, right? Scripture says he saw her. Ran to her, kissed her, and wept. That's kind of an odd introduction. He sees her, having just got there. Ran to her, kissed her, wept. So then she ran off and told her dad about it. Hey, your relative's here. And so he came out to greet him. And this is where we pick up our story for this morning. Let's pray. Let's hear the word of our Lord. Lord God, prepare our hearts to receive what you have for us. As I read through this, Lord God, I pray that you would speak through directly that my inadequacies do not hinder the ability of your people to hear your word. Teach us, Lord, and lead us. Receive our praise, and above all things, be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, as you see here, I want to point this out real quick. I have scripture reference underneath the title. One of our fine folks here in our church family made that suggestion last week because she didn't have enough time to find the passage ahead of time. So she asked me about that. This is how it works, folks. Talk to me, and I'll talk to you. We are together in relationship. Help me to help you. So, Darlene, thank you for the heads up. So we'll be looking at Genesis 29, verses 14 through 30. Hope you can see that. If not, I hope you have your Bibles. After Jacob had stayed with him for a whole month, Laban said to him, "Just because you are a relative of mine, should you work for me for nothing? Tell me what your wages should be." Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah, and the younger, Rachel. Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Jacob was in love with Rachel and said, "I'll work for you 7 years in return for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It's better that I give her to you than some other man. Stay here with me." So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife. My time is completed, and I want to make love to her." So Laban brought together all the people of the place and gave a feast. But when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and Jacob made love to her. And Laban gave his servant Zelpeth to his daughter as her attendant. When morning came, there was Leah. So Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me?" Laban replied, "It is not our custom here to give the younger daughter in marriage before the older one. Finish this daughter's bridal week, then we will give you the younger one also, in return for another 7 years of work." And David did so. He finished the week with Leah, and then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife. Laban gave his servant Bilhah to his daughter Rachel as her attendant. Jacob made love to Rachel also, and his love for Rachel was greater than his love for Leah. And he worked for Laban another 7 years. Let's pray again. That was a lot, so I'm going to give you time to process. Lord God, we thank you for this truth and this story that you've given us. We pray again that you would reveal what you have through your scriptures. Help us, Lord, to be prepared and to connect the dots that your Holy Spirit leads us to. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen. So there's a couple interesting points or reminders that I want to bring up to help you visualize this. Well, most of all, or first of all, most of you know that women didn't particularly have a whole lot of rights back then. Now, we kind of just witnessed that. There wasn't much recognition or accolades given to women. And marriage wasn't any different. So it was conducted mostly as a business transaction between the parents, the woman's adult brothers, and the groom. Just kind of leaving the woman out there to figure out who she's going with and when and all that. So let's keep that in mind and then look at something that's many times overlooked. I'm not saying you overlooked it, but many times it is. So this is a business transaction, essentially. The parents, the woman's adult brothers, and the groom. Well, Jacob, half of the main characters of the story, was approximately 77 years old when he arrived at Laban's. And after the 7 years when he married Leah and Rachel, he was about 84. So that math was done counting backwards from Joseph and figure it out. So he was 84 when he got married. So Jacob wasn't this young little love-struck puppy. He's been around a while. One other thing I am going to point out, I wasn't sure if I was going to. Going through and looking through many past historical documents and different theologians' perspectives and commentaries, doing the math for Rachel puts her in the category of 15 to 21. So he's 84 and she's 21, 25 maybe, depending on whose math you go by. changes the image in your head a little bit when you hear the story, doesn't it? It's not like two young little teenagers like, oh, No, that's not the case. So keep that in mind. We're going to go back to the passage to look at our first point. There we go. Love made the years of labor fly by. That's our first point. Y'all heard the term, a labor of love is no labor at all. Or time flies when you're having fun. I hope you've heard one of those at least. I see a head bobbing. I appreciate it. Let's look at verse 20. So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. I don't know what I can add to that. That's pretty clear, right? Because he loved her, the 7 years of labor was like nothing. Okay. It's interesting because I use the term, a labor of love is no labor at all. And that's important because when we look at it, we have to remember that Jacob was working tending the livestock of Laban. We learn that later on as we read about how he deals with the goats, the sheep, and multiplies his property and all this. But he's out there doing work. He's not sitting there pretending to do work. It says he's successful and he's working hard. So 7 years of hard work is like days because of his love for her. And one of the things with that, when we push beyond the understanding of working, is earning. So yes, we see he loves her, but Jacob is earning her. So whereas before Jonathan, David, the relationship was like that. Saul's like, yeah, you're mine. Let's go. We're good. We see this one. There seems to be immediate love, but he can't have her. He's got to work for her. He's got to earn her. That's his wages. As I was realizing that, and it's a simple concept. I wouldn't think I would forget that. But as I was re-realizing that, I'm like, oh, that kind of takes the romance out of the romance story. But then you read that his love for her made that work like it wasn't work. But a few days. Let's move right into the next point. Because we can. Love triumphs over challenges. So in that passage of scripture, do we recognize any challenges that were present for Jacob? Yeah, Rick did. I appreciate it, buddy. There's a few challenges listed. Let's take a look at a few of those examples. But when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and Jacob made love to her. When morning came, there was Leah. So Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me?" Well, that's a pretty big challenge. His love was for Rachel. It's not what he got. His agreement was for Rachel. It's not what he got. So just in that little passage, let's try to identify some. He was deceived by his father-in-law. He got a wife he didn't want. And he had to work 14 years to get the wife he did want. Well, there's some challenges. There's some challenges for sure. See, Jacob, in the 14 years of labor, continued to love Rachel. Yet he had another wife. And as we've learned in the past, It's not just a relationship, especially in Old Testament time. There's responsibilities that come with being the husband of a wife, according to the family and caring. So he had to deal with that. One of the more traumatic, for me at least, and potentially challenging ones. This guy was single until he was 84. Now he's got two wives. Not just two wives, two sisters. Yeah. That's a challenge. That's a challenge. So he got two wives after being single for so long. He lives in the household of the guy who just deceived him and tricked him to pawn his other daughter off. Now he's got two female servants too. Life is different. But he loved Rachel, so it was okay. Many times, we forget the power of love. It becomes something we say. I love you. Well, we just saw what love does, right? When we were doing our praise portion, we saw the many characteristics of love. And this story exemplifies that. Love does not fail. Love overcomes. Love perseveres. Third point. So we already saw love made the years of labor fly by. We see love triumphs over all the challenges that you faced. Point three. We do not earn true love. It is given. Rachel did nothing to earn Jacob's love. We already talked about how because of his love, the challenges seemed to be nothing. The time seemed to be small. And now as we look, it's even more impressive because she didn't do anything to earn that love. She was who she was created to be. And that's it. She was who she was created to be, and Jacob loved her. He freely gave her that love, despite having to earn the ability to share it with her. Let's look at the other half of that love triangle real quick. We see that love was given freely from Jacob to Rachel simply because she was who she was created as. Now we got Leah. Put yourself in her position for one moment as you look at this love story. She's the older daughter. She's described as having weak eyes. Basically, when you look at it, unattractive. So she's in the situation being the older daughter who customarily would be married first, who would have her opportunity to be a wife and bear sons to bless their family and grow. And she was passed over. For 7 years, she dealt with that, knowing that her little sister was going to be a bride first and had the love that she does not know. But then she got Jacob. Now she got him deceitfully, but she got Jacob. So in her mind, I'm married. Okay. All right. Then she gives birth to a son. And in that time, that culture, we already learned and we know from the past, sons were a blessing. And they blessed your family. So when a man had sons, it increased his prominence. Right? So Leah gave birth to sons. And in doing so, she believed that it would earn Jacob's love for her. In fact, we see that in the scripture. She says, now my husband will love me because I'm giving him sons. Despite that, Jacob's love did not grow for Leah. And Jacob's love for Rachel remained even when she did not bear him any sons. Look at that contrast. Look at that contrast and make the parallel to your lives right now. My life. The life that many people believe out there is the way to be. I can earn love. Now, don't get me wrong. Love takes work in relationships to continue to be fruitful in them. And that takes work and commitment. But true love is not earned. It is given. Poor Leah was in the position where she did not get this love. She tried so hard to earn it by doing the things of that time to normally earn love, to gain prominence. Many believers now think, I go to church every Sunday. I give my tithe. You know what? I even said, God bless you to somebody the other day. Perhaps it's more practical than that. Man, I'm really a good guy. I help people all the time. I serve over here at the soup kitchen. I push carts back into the building when they get left out. I do my good stuff. I know God loves me more now. And then there's Rachel. Being who she was created to be, living her life in receipt of Jacob's full love. As we move further into the story, you'll eventually see that Rachel does have children. And this whole time, she's crying out, Lord, help me, I want to. So the desire is there for her. She wants to be able to do what needs to be done for her family. She wants to do the work, but it's not to earn the love. To help grow the love. The love's never left. Look at that. Look at that for today. You have the love. It's here. It's not going anywhere. That love should spur you, should drive you, encourage you to do the things that we're called to do. Not vice versa. You don't do all the good things to earn the love. You will miss the mark if that's your model. If you think you can earn God's love by doing the good deeds, you're missing the concept of true love. Yet while we were still sinners, Christ died, right? For whom? For us. Even before you had a chance to do these good deeds, Christ died for you. That's true love, freely given. I don't want to dog on Leah because that's not the case. She was blessed. Look at the contrast. She was who she was created to be in the situation she was placed, and she was loved. Leah was in the position she was in, created the way she was, and tried to do everything she could to earn love that was not there. Don't do that. Don't be that. I'm telling you this morning, God's love is there, not earnable. There's nothing you can do to earn it. Was freely given for you to accept it. Between last week and this week, we've read very different and very powerful stories of love. How powerful it can be to relationships, how powerful it can have an impact on kingdoms. That same love is here today. Every Sunday we come together and we sing songs of that love. We sing songs to God about how much He loves us, how much we love Him. We go about our life thinking we have to earn it. That love is given by a thing called grace. We had a whole bunch of sermons on them at the end of the year. You were loved by the Creator of the universe. And not because you're a good person. God's love, freely given through Jesus Christ, many of you have already accepted Christ. Many of you already know that that love is there. We struggle at living in it at times. So for you, if you have a relationship with Jesus right now, I encourage you, please take a step back and recognize the power and majesty of the love that you have lavished upon you. The grace of our God given to us because He loves us. Live in that grace. Live in that love. Do not try to earn it. Do not think that it's just something that is paid to you, that you deserve it, because you don't. But for those of you who may not have accepted Christ yet, who may not know about that relationship, it's easy. It's easy. You recognize, just like you recognize this morning, wow, Rachel did nothing. She was just who she was, and that love was there. And Jacob went through all these challenges, all these hardships to make sure that he could love her, that there could be relationship. That can be you. Right now, if you haven't accepted Christ, all you got to do is acknowledge that you're a sinner, that you need Jesus Christ to save you. You acknowledge that, Lord God, I have sinned and I'm sorry. I don't want to. Please help me. I ask you, God, to save me. Jesus, be my Savior. And you can do that right where you're sitting. You can come forward and you can do that with me and we can pray together right now. You can find me after service and we can pray. The point of the matter is I need you to understand that you are loved and not because of something you did. When you fully embrace that, your life changes. That love becomes a source of joy. And all those characteristics and attributes that are assigned to love that we looked at through the songs this morning and the readings is truth. Understand, we are called to be like Rachel. Receive the love that He has given us. Lavish in the love that He's given us. Desire to love Him better, to do the things that we're directed and instructed to do, to glorify Him and show Him our love for Him. But not to earn it. God's true love is truly beyond our comprehension. But looking at the stories in Scripture, we can see small glimpses of how powerful it is. And as we move into this next song, again, I'm going to encourage you, if you've already accepted Jesus Christ, praise God. Thank you for acknowledging that and being part of this church family. If you'd like to pray with me, I'm here. I'm ready. But I want you, while we're singing, to reflect upon the goodness of God and His love for you. Given freely, not earned. Let's pray together. Almighty Father, we thank you so much for that love you've given us. Lord, not only giving us, but lavished upon us. Freely given, Lord, as you created us. Lord, we pray right now that you would help us to recognize that love, Lord, to live in the grace that you've given us through your Son.
that our lives may reflect that into the world, that people may see us and know us by our love, that they may see our lives and have the question, what are you doing to earn that? And we can say, nothing. Jesus is our Savior. Help us to do that, Lord God. And we pray that in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we sing, Just a Closer Walk with Thee? Just a closer walk with Thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to Thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Close with Days of Elijah this morning, and we're just going out with the joy of the love of the Lord.
Temple of praise, and these are the days of the
Praise God. You feel invigorated, recharged, remembering how much you are loved by God, the Creator? I hope so. I hope so. Thank you, Lord, for being present. Let's pray together. Almighty Father, we thank you for the blessing and opportunity it is to be called your children, to be loved by you in a way we can't even comprehend. Lord, I pray that you take us out into the world, that we may glorify you through our love for your world. We pray this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. May the love of our Lord God be with you as you go about your day.